Good morning, North Livingston. It's good to see everybody in the house of the Lord this morning. If you would, let's stand as we open our service with a time of prayer. I think it's officially vacation season. We have a bunch of people out, some just coming in on a wing and a prayer and needing a nap, and others getting ready to go. So we want to remember everybody that's traveling and will be traveling. Continue to lift up Lynn. We praise the Lord. Lynn had his procedure this week. Went well. We thank the Lord for that. Continue to remember Lynn. We have some that have asked just to remember them in an unspoken way, and God knows the need. So let's remember those needs. Also, the bereaved in our community. Brother Harold Rittenberry has passed away. That funeral is this afternoon. That's Helen's brother, Buddy's uncle. Remember that family. Also, Miss Vera Nelson. Many know Miss Vera. Remember her family. And Sherry Lasher, next door, her dad, Tom Guess, has passed away. So remember that. Also, some around Marion, some families that we know. You probably wouldn't know them, but just continue to lift them up. We have several families that are bereaved in our community, so let's lift them up. Do you have concerns, prayer requests, maybe updates on some?
My cousin David Coughlin, he got released. Staying with his sister there in Chicago. He seems to be doing much
better. All right. Daryl's cousin, remember this need. Anyone else?
Ranger is having the same thing that him and Lenny had on Tuesday.
All right. That's having that done when?
Tuesday.
Okay. Charlene is not feeling well. Remember Charlene. And as I said, remember, Eric and them are traveling this weekend, and Joe and Tina are traveling. Joe's dad, continue to lift them up. Others that'll be on vacation this coming week, just remember all those that are traveling. Let's go to the Lord in a time of prayer. Father, we thank you for this Lord's Day. God, we thank you for our church family. Father, we thank you for the privilege of getting together on the first day of the week, the Lord's Day. And Father, we are so blessed when we just pause and realize that it's not just us gathering, but there's a promise with our gathering, and that is that you are here in our midst. God, we just appreciate so much your presence with us today. Father, we thank you for our Sunday school hour, our discipleship hour, and those that work and prepare to bring those lessons. And God, we just thank you that the Spirit is active in those times, in those services. God, we pray for our time together now. God, we pray that you would be with each home that's represented. Father, there's needs and concerns within these homes. Some of these have been voiced. Some are in the form of unspoken needs. Father, we've lifted the names of these that have lost family members to death. And Father, for those that know you as Savior, we know that they're in your presence today. And God, for that, we're joyful. But God, those families are hurting today, grieving today. Father, some that will have the funerals today, some coming this week, some that have had funerals in the past even year and further, but they're still grieving. And God, we lift those to you today. God, we thank you that your word gives a promise, and that is that you give us a peace that passes all human reasoning and understanding. And God, we ask that for those families today. God, those that need a healing touch, we pray that we would just, God, we ask for miracles. God, there's some in our church family that have those in their families that the doctor's diagnosis is bleak. And God, they're really turning to you, depending to you. They're trusting you and asking for your will to be done. And God, we're joining our faith, our prayers together today as we lift those, God, and we ask that you touch. God, we pray that you'd be in our time together today. God, I pray that you would just let the anointing of the Holy Spirit be with everything that's said and done. God, I pray that you'd be with Dave and the team as they lead us in a time of worship today. God, help us to turn our hearts, our minds towards you as we worship you in song. And then, Father, I pray for the anointing of the Holy Spirit as we look into your word today. God, the things that the scripture teaches that we do, God, we pray that the Holy Spirit's anointing would just be in this place today. And God, that word would challenge us, that Father, we would be more determined, to be more Christ-like as a result of our having been here today. God, we love you. We thank you. We give this service into your hands. It's in the name of Jesus that we ask. And all of God's people said, amen. You may be seated. We have a thank you note here from Laura Bull's family. They had requested in lieu of flowers that a gift be made to Brother Bob's church. And so we did that. And this is from the church and from the family in memory of Bob Perry, gratefully acknowledging our contribution to their family. And that'll be on the bulletin board for you to be able to look at. Continue to lift Laura, especially her mother, continue to lift them up in prayer in the loss of Brother Bob. Just as I said, some where maybe the funerals have already happened, but those families are still grieving. And we understand that. So we certainly want to remember those families. Brother Dave, come lead us in a time of worship, brother.
Good morning. Glad to see everybody in the house of the Lord this morning. Glad the ladies are here. I see. Has anybody got anything on their heart this morning? Before we get started?
I've got to tell you something sweet. I'm going to tell it on Jesse. But a few weeks ago, we had a lesson at Sunday school. It was going to be Landon doing it. He didn't get to come that day. But it was about when the people, the church needed monies to operate. So people were collecting all the monies from everywhere, giving it to it at the gate of the temple. And so the story was to take these coins, clean the coins, and give them to the church. So I had some pennies that was in Lennon's work bar, and it fit in that, you know, you got the little spot you throw coins in. Oh, it had these pennies in.
Anybody else? I'd like to praise the Lord for the ones that got saved last week and baptized. Anybody else? All right, precious memories. All right, why me, Lord? Train. Always makes me think of Mrs. Evelyn.
You
Brother Larry, would you take us to the Lord, please?
Thank you and praise the Lord for another day of God. Also for another opportunity to come to your house. Praise you, and hear your word, Lord. We just thank you and praise the Lord for the many gifts, Lord, that you give us each and every day. We just thank you, Lord, most of all, for your gift of salvation, made possible by your shed blood, for it's in your name, Lord Jesus Christ, we pray.
I'm going to ask if you'd open your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 12. 1 Corinthians, chapter number 12. We are talking about, coming off of the last couple of weeks, why we do the things that we do, some of the things that we do, some of the things that we say in the church. And as I shared with you last week, if you've not been raised in church or around church for any length of time, some of the things that we do, some of the things that we say, some of the terminology, it's kind of not like the rest of the world, kind of hard to understand some of those things, like the long black train, talking about train of sin. You don't understand some of those things if you've not been around the church. I remember that song, Precious Memories, when I was a kid. I remember hating that song. And the reason I hated it was because the first place I heard it, I was just a kid went to a funeral down at White's Chapel. I remember sitting there, just this vivid sitting there, the casket up front. This guy had worked for my dad, knew him real well for a long time. Probably one of the first funerals I had been to. I know there was other songs that were sang, there was words that were said, things that were done, but I just remember that song and looking at that casket and associating that song with that funeral. Now, after I got older and began to understand Precious Memories, then I like the song now because it does remind you of those that we love that have gone on. But at that time, I can remember just thinking, didn't really understand what that was all about. Why we go and sit in a hot building and there's a body up front and then we take that out and we put it in the ground and no explanation as a child of really what all this was about. So it was a long period of time of trying to figure this out and understand what that was. So, that being said, what we did last Sunday, a baptism. If you're not familiar with church, if you've not been in church, if you just turn on Facebook and you see pictures of people sitting in a box of water and a guy dunking them under, sometimes that doesn't make a lot of sense. Why do we do what we do? Why do we say some of the things that we say? What are some of the terms? I mean, get saved. Saved from what? Get born again. Like Nicodemus, how in the world do you do that? The blood that washes white as snow. I can remember as a child that phrase, the blood washing white as snow, and trying to, how in the world does blood wash something? Now, you get older, not only do you understand the spiritual aspects of that, but when you understand the biology of what blood does in the body, how the blood carries the oxygen and it carries the carbon dioxide, and how that the blood really has those, as a transporter, the ability to clean, and how Jesus's blood, spiritually, how we apply that. And so as we think about some of those things, I wanted us to spend a little time, and we spent the last couple of weeks on baptism, but even before baptism, church membership, what is that? You've got the Lions Club and the Kiwanis Club and the Rotary Club, and you got the Republican Party and the Democrat Party, and everybody wants you to be a member of something. So what's the difference in membership? and membership in a church. And when you get born again, when you get saved, you become a member of the church, the universal church. But then what is this getting baptized into and joining? And then those that were baptized last week that would have a desire to join the local church, North Livingston Baptist Church. And then in a couple of weeks, we'll have a business meeting. And in that business meeting, we will vote on those that want to become a member of this particular local body. What does that mean? And then when you become a member of the church, you become a part of the body of Christ. How does that work? You become a part of the bride of Christ. What are we talking about there? Well, the scriptures teach us. And in the church, we need to teach what we mean when we say these things. So 1 Corinthians chapter number 12, Paul writes a lot of our New Testament letters, our New Testament Bible. These are letters written to churches in the first century. But then God inspired those writings and had them become part of the Bible for our teaching. Some, here we are 2,000 plus years later. And so when Paul is writing this letter to this church in Corinth, in fact, he's written a couple of letters to them because they have some issues going on in this first century church. This church is a new thing. This idea of men and women joining a church and coming together for fellowship and what we do on Sunday. You'll hear us refer to this as the Lord's Day, this first day of the week. You hear some references to Sabbath, the Sabbath day, which is the seventh day of the week. And so do we go to church on the Sabbath or do we go to church on the Lord's Day? And what's the difference in the Sabbath and the Lord's Day? And so all of those teachings. So Paul is writing to this church. We get over to 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. And because they have been having some issues in that church, and God knows it's some things that we as a church, we as Christians, we as part of the body of Christ, we as those that are born again, we'll need to know God has it part of our Bible. So 1 Corinthians chapter number 12, Paul is addressing this issue of church membership. He's describing what it's like. And he begins in verse number 12, and he makes an analogy. He makes a comparison between the church and a physical body, this body that we inhabit. And this is what he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse number 12, about church membership. For just as the body is one and has many parts, and all of the parts of that body, though many, are one body, so also is Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit, capital S-P-I-R-T, that's the third part of God, the third person, the Trinity. We were all baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether we were Jews or Greeks, whether we were slaves or free. And we were all given one Spirit to drink. Indeed, the body is not one part, but many. And if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body, it is not for that reason any less a part of the body. Verse number 16. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I don't belong to the body, it is not for that reason any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? And if the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God has arranged each one of the parts in the body just as he wanted. Verse number 19, if they were all the same part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. Or again, the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that are weaker are indispensable. And those parts of the body that we consider less honorable, we clothe these with greater honor, and our unrespectable parts are treated with greater respect, which our respectable parts do not need. Instead, God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the less honorable, so that there would be no division in the body, but that the members would have the same concern for each other. So, if one of the members suffer, all of the members suffer with it. And if one of the members is honored, all of the members rejoice with it. Now, you are the body of Christ and individual members of it. Let's ask God to help us in our time together. Father, we do thank you for your word. God, we read a passage like this, and sometimes the reading of the scripture is difficult to understand. Sometimes these analogies are hard for us to grasp. And yet, God, you've put this in the Bible because it's important. God, you are God, the creator of the universe. And in your mind, you determined that it was important for us to understand this idea of church membership, this idea of salvation making us a part of the body of Christ. So I ask in these next few moments that the Holy Spirit, the Spirit that we're baptized into, this Spirit that you promised is present with us here today, I pray that that anointing of the Spirit would help us to understand more what it means to be part of the body, what it means to be a member of the church. Let the Holy Spirit clarify this in our time together today, and we'll give you the honor and the glory, do you? Because it's in Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's people said, amen. Talking about the church, why is it important that we join, that we become a member of the church? What was Paul saying to these people, and why did God deem it important enough to make it part of our Bible that we would read this some 2,000 years later? So talking about the church, when you think about the church is not a social organization like the Lions Club or the Kiwanis Club or the Rotary Club. Now we do socialize, we do fellowship together. There's things that we do socially, but we're not namely a social organization. We're not a civic organization, although we do try our best to impact our communities. But the church is different than just a social group, different than just a civic group. We're not namely a charitable organization, even though sometimes we clean our pennies up and donate our pennies to do certain things. We're more than a charitable organization. We're not an activist organization, although we do advocate for our causes, for the things that we believe in. But the church is more than that. And that's what Paul is trying to get us to see here. We're not just an educational organization, even though we're all about teaching. I mean, if it weren't for the church, you take a lot of your higher education institutions in the United States of America, it was the church that founded most of these Ivy League colleges that we have. The church was all about education, the importance of education, but we are not namely just an educational organization. You see, what Paul is driving home here, what the church is being the body of Christ. And so Paul gives this analogy to this first century church here about the body, the importance of the different members of the body, and belonging to the church being an incredible privilege. He talks about the unbelievable honor. He talks about the weighty responsibility that I'm afraid far too many of us take too lightly concerning our membership in the church. We get saved, we get born again, we get baptized, we become part of the church, and then sometimes we take that for granted. It's not that we just don't see the importance of the day-to-day, I'm afraid. And yet Paul is trying to show this church and thereby God making it part of the Bible, God's inspiration for it becoming part of the canon of our Bible, he's saying it's important that you understand why you become a member of the church. Now, when a person is born again, when a person, and we've talked about this at length, how the Holy Spirit convicts you of sin and the Holy Spirit draws you and the Holy Spirit has you to realize at that moment that you're a sinner and you ask God to forgive you, you instantly become a part of what we call the universal church, headquartered in heaven. When you're born again, when you ask God to forgive you of your sins, and instantly because of what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary, you're saved from hell. You're saved to a life of service to God. You're saved for eternity in heaven. And somewhere in heaven, we're told, the scriptures teach us that there is a book. We call it the book of life. And God writes your name in that book of life when you pray that prayer and you say, God, I'm a sinner and I need to be saved. I want to be saved. God, forgive me of my sins based upon what Jesus did. I believe Jesus was your son. God, would you forgive me? And instantly God saves us and God writes our name in the, what we call in the scriptures teach us is the Lamb's book of life. See all these terms that it's, what is that? Who is the Lamb? The Lamb's book of life. Your name is written in a book in heaven and it can never be blotted out. It can never be erased. What are we even talking about there? You see, Paul is trying to get the church. Paul is trying to get the Corinthians. Paul is trying to get us to see and to identify exactly what does that mean? Why is it important if when I'm born again, when I'm saved, God writes my name in the Lamb's book of life, if God writes my name in the book in heaven and I'm a part of the universal church, what's all of this about joining a local church? Why is that important? Upon salvation, we're instantly connected with the family, the Christ followers, that all that have ever been and all that ever will be. In Romans chapter 12, Paul talking to the Christians in the area of Rome, just like he was talking to the ones in Corinth. He says in Romans chapter 12, beginning at verse number 4, he says, now, as we have many parts in one body, the same analogy, he's talking about a body. Now, as we have many parts in one body and all the parts do not have the same function. Verse number 5, Romans chapter 12, in the same way, we who are many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. So what is this about this? If God writes my name in the Lamb's book of life and this, it's invisible to me, I can't see that. I can't reach out and take a hold of that book. But why is it important then that I have membership in a visible local church? Is there a difference? Is it important as a Christ follower? And I submit to you today, based upon what Paul writes here in the Bible, what God has written in the Bible, that church membership is very important. If you go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, what Paul is telling the church there, they were dealing with some problems. They were dealing with some serious unity issues within the church. They were dealing with some immorality issues within the church. They were having some leadership issues in the church. And Paul says, guys, gals, I want you to see the importance of you becoming a member, a part of what we celebrated, what we participated in last Sunday in the baptism. Something has already happened, and we talked about this last week. Something has already happened when you're born again that happens in your heart, in your spirit, in your soul, and God records your name in heaven. God records your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. But then we come to the local church and we have a baptismal service, a baptismal ceremony. Now, we talked about the Ethiopian eunuch. He wasn't in a church building. He was with Philip riding along, and they were having a discussion. And because he had believed that Jesus was the Son of God and that Jesus's death on the cross had paid the penalty for his sins, if he would but ask, and then he's baptized in a pool of water outside, but it was a baptismal service, much like what we did last week here. And the reason we did that last week here is we were baptizing because that's an act of obedience in following what Jesus did in his public ministry. And then those that were baptized last week, and sometimes we baptize and they choose not to become a part of that local church. You can be baptized and not baptized into a local church. You're being baptized just as an act of obedience in what Jesus did. But baptism is also and can be a part of someone saying, I want to affiliate with, I want to join, I want to be a part of that local body, that local church, so I will have a place, an identifiable place where I can serve. And we talked last week also about that being a prerequisite. There's two ordinances in the church, baptism and the Lord's Supper. And baptism is a prerequisite. It's something you have to do according to Scripture. You have to be baptized if you have the opportunity after you're saved in order to participate in the Lord's Supper. Now, we're going to talk more about that next week. Next week here at North, we commemorate the Lord's Supper whenever we have a fifth Sunday. Lord's Supper, communion, it's all the same thing. And we're going to talk about that more next Sunday, why we do that. But it's what we did last week. You have to be a baptized believer in order to participate in the Lord's Supper. And so Paul is making the case here. He's talking about this church membership. He's talking about the understanding that when you become a member of that church, it's just like a picture of the body. Go back to verses 22 to 26 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. He's talking about the body, the parts of the body. And he says how foolish it would be if one part of the body said to another part of the body, I don't need you. What if the eye were to say, go back to verse 21, the eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. Or the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. In verse 22, Paul gives a description of this. He says, on the contrary, the parts of the body that are weaker are indispensable. And those parts of the body that we consider less honorable, we clothe with greater honor. And our unrespectable parts, that part's just not important, you would say. And Paul says, on the contrary, it is important. Every member of the body of Christ matters. Some would say, well, I'm not a teacher, I'm not important. I'm not the preacher, it doesn't matter if I show up or not. I'm not a deacon, I'm not an officer in the church, it doesn't matter nobody will know if I'm not there. Paul says, on the contrary, every part is just as important as the other part. Take the pupil of your eye. Hey, maybe you know what a pupil of your eye is. Can you point to it? You know where it is, right? We teach the little kids, where's your eye? Here's my eye. What's the pupil? It's the tiniest part. How many of you go to the eye doctor? And you sit down in the eye doctor's chair. And the eye doctor across the way has a picture of the eye. And it's got all these parts. And you hope your eye doctor knows all of those parts of the eye and what they all do. And that pupil is one of the smallest parts of the eye. I think that they say the pupil of the eye, if you're in a place where it's in a real bright light, that pupil is like 2 to 4 millimeters. I mean, it's tiny. And then if you turn the lights off and it gets dark, as large as it gets is somewhere like 4 to 8 millimeters. And you think, well, that's a very small part of a very small part of the body. But when that pupil doesn't work correctly, you got problems. There's so many things that the pupil does. It controls how much light is in and the speed of the light and when the light comes in. And you would think that's such a small part, it couldn't be important. The point Paul is making, sometimes we think nobody would miss me if I weren't even there. And Paul says, how untrue that is. When you think about those, what he calls the less seemly, the less respectable parts of the body. Here's a good one. Men, my age and older, nose hairs. They begin to multiply and get a lot bigger than they ought to be. And your wife just can't stand not plucking it. And you think a nose hair, would you rather be a nose hair or a lung of the body? Well, naturally you want to be the lung, right? You control the livelihood if you're the lung. I mean, the lung is the important part, right? The lung is the exchange of the oxygen and the carbon dioxide. And if the lung doesn't work, the body's going to just shut down and die. I want to be a lung. Who would want to be a nose hair? And yet the importance, David said, when he was talking about the body, David said, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I'm not God. If I were God, I don't know if I would have had enough sense to come up with nose hairs. Nose hairs. What does a nose hair, ladies, you have them too. Yours just don't get out of control when you get older like ours does. I'm conscientious now of ear hair because my ear hair gets plucked so often that, you know, that I'm constantly thinking, I wonder if that's sticking out there like a big bush right now. You know? But nose hairs, ear hairs, that's what Paul is talking about when he says the less seemly, the not so respectable, the what we would consider the unimportant. And yet if you lose all of your nose hairs, you lose the filtration system that filters all of the allergens out of your body before it gets into the lungs, all of the histamines that controls all of the stuff. And it's not seemly stuff to talk about the snot and all that stuff that goes on. But Paul is simply saying, I want you to understand the importance. Take your capillaries. I mean, who wouldn't want to be an aorta, right? The big, whatever you call it, vein that goes to the heart. I mean, you want to be that main blood supply line, right? That's the guy to be. But your capillaries are just these tiny little vessels all throughout your body. And you think you'd rather be the aorta. You'd rather be an artery. But you see, the capillaries are so necessary because the capillaries at the base of all of biology, the capillaries are where those smallest of little vessels in the blood system. That's where all of the exchange takes place of the good oxygen and the waste carbon dioxide. That all happens at a capillary level. What is Paul saying? What am I saying? All of us that make up the body are important. And Paul is giving this analogy. Paul is giving this picture of this body of the church. of us being members. He gives us biblical examples of the church. If you look at all that he says about the ecclesia, the gathering, the meeting, and he talks about the biblical examples of the church being the local community of believers who gather for worship, and then we go out to do the service. We come in here to get fed. We come in here to get encouraged. We gather in here as the body, like the training ground. But then we go out there to actually do the work, to be the body. It's biblical, all that he says about the church and joining the church. The Bible, you won't find a scripture that says thou shalt become a member of the local church. There's not a scripture that says that. But over and over, the Bible gives us examples and the Bible gives teachings that shows the importance of being a part. All of Paul's, the majority of Paul's writings in the New Testament are written to local New Testament churches. He's writing to the congregation in Corinth. He's writing to the congregation in Galatia. He's writing to the congregation in Ephesus. And over we see in these letters, he's addressing a local body. The example, the biblical example is there, that we become a part of a local body of believers. He talks about the offices of the church. He talks about the deacons and the elders. He talks about the pastors. You wouldn't have deacons, you wouldn't have elders, you wouldn't have pastors, you wouldn't have preachers if you didn't have a body. And so he gives us this picture here. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, it says that members of the church should honor the officers of the church who work hard among you and warn you against all that is wrong or incorrect. If there weren't a body, there wouldn't be that admonition in there that we would find. He tells us in Matthew chapter 18, he tells us what to do if somebody is in a sin, if somebody's taken in a fault in the church. He's giving us the picture of church discipline. There wouldn't be such scripture if there wasn't a body. So we see over and over the biblical example of the local church. The clear process is given. Not only do we see the biblical example, but then he shows us that it's meaningful. When we look at Paul's analogy of the body, we readily see that each member has a meaningful, important place, an important function. And again, we may feel that we're insignificant or not important because we're one of the least, but he points out there's not a least among us. It's all important. He gives that picture of everything that's there. I've got some things going on in this body right now. You've been hearing me talk about those. Some things that are causing pain in the body. I was at the doctor this week and I was diagnosing myself. She was saying, this is what we're looking for. And I says, that's not the problem. This is what's going on. And here's her words. In my line of work, we're gonna rule out the things that will kill you first. And then we'll come back to what you think is wrong. Now, I have no doubt my diagnosis is gonna be right. But there are some little things in the body that when those little things go wrong, they can kill you. And so the doctors look at those little things, those insignificant things, because they're all important to the viability of the body. So it's meaningful to be a part of a local body. There's biblical example throughout the Bible for being a part of a local body. Not only that, it's identifiable. If you look at the membership in the local New Testament church, it shows us that there's the membership in the local church is an affirmation, a public statement that we are in fact a follower of Jesus Christ. It identifies us with a group. Those who are accepted into membership are people whom we believe have a personal relationship with Jesus. In other words, they're a card-carrying Jesus representative to the world. Not that they get a card to carry, but we see the importance. The biblical example is there. It identifies us and it holds us accountable. You hear people all the time, I can worship God, I can worship Jesus in a deer stand, and no doubt you can. But you can't do it as well as you can in a local body of believers. It holds us accountable. We need to have people in our lives that hold us accountable and that we're accountable to. And being a member of the local church automatically brings those people into your life. As I said, Matthew, the Gospels tells us what to do as far as the church discipline and being accountable and how that we respond to those times when someone has a problem, has a sin in their life, and how we're to be accountable. And then it's beneficial. Being a member of the local church is just good for you. It provides you with much needed components for a strong walk with Jesus. As I said, you can worship Jesus in a deer stand, but you can't serve him as well in the deer stand as you can. You can't serve him as well on a golf course as you can when you're part of a local body. The local body gives you spiritual nourishment. It gives you service opportunities. It gives you sincere relationships, and it gives you a strong support system. Look at what he says in verse number 26 of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. He says, so if one member suffers, all of the members suffer with it. We're part of one another. If one member is honored or one member rejoices, all of the members rejoice with it. You're part of the body, and you're individual members belonging to the church. Means that you've invested your life in a gospel-centered community, a community of believers who joyfully serve one another and have as our goal, our function is to advance Jesus's mission. Now, we come to that point. So, have I joined a local body? Am I part of a local body where I can serve? We talked last week about baptism being a public statement of something that's happened inside. Maybe you've been attending and worshiping, but you've not made the step to say, I want to become a part of. I feel led to become a part of. God is showing me I need to become a part of. I'm a born-again Christian by testimony, by statement. Now I need to be a part of the local body. And if you've not done that, if you're not a part of that local body, that's what Paul is talking about, the need, the importance of. And then there are others that you know you're not a part of a local body because you're not born again. And that's the most important thing we can ever do. Because as I said at the beginning of this, that's when you admit you're a sinner, you recognize the need to have your sins covered by the blood of Jesus, you realize the need, the Holy Spirit's drawing you to be able to say, I need God to forgive me based upon what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary. I believe Jesus was God's son and I need to be born again. I want to be born again. I want to be saved. And so you pray that prayer. And then in praying that prayer, God puts your name in that Lamb's book of life. But you recognize that when that happens, you also need to, the accountability part of it, the nourishment part of it, become a part of a local body. So church membership, why we do what we do, why we say that's important, why we do the baptisms, it's because the Bible teaches. It's because God's word teaches that that's what we do. So, are you a part of the local church? Have you asked to become a part of a local church, a place where you can serve? Or perhaps you are part of the local church, but maybe, as I said earlier, you've just been taking that for granted and you've not been faithful to that. You've not been committed to that. And you need to ask God to help you. You need to ask God to help you be more accountable. Wherever group you fall in there, if the Holy Spirit's speaking to you this morning, I'm going to have Dave and the team to come up. We're going to have a hymn of invitation. Do you need to be saved today? Is the Holy Spirit drawing you today? The Holy Spirit convicting you today? Don't leave without having taken care. Maybe you're watching by way of internet and you say, you know, I'm not part of a local church and I need to be a part of a local church. Pick up the phone, make a phone call. Get a hold of a local pastor and say, I need to be a part of the local church, or I need to be saved. I want to be saved. Whatever the Holy Spirit is leading you to do, be obedient to what that Spirit is asking you to do today. As you stand. Dave, what are we singing?
Take my hand, press the floor.
Some singing, some praying, but all being obedient to what the Holy Spirit's asking you to do today. Thank you for your attendance today. Thank you for your attention. May we all be praying that the Holy Spirit would speak to us, speak to our family members, use us to be that light, to be that witness. We come into the church, as I said, to be nourished, to be encouraged, to be taught, but we go out there because that's the mission field. That's where we are to be that light. The Bible talks about us being light, talks about us being salt. And again, what does that mean? To be an influence for Christ. To tell your story. You don't have to have a bunch of scripture memorized or a what would I say if I witnessed to somebody. Just tell your story. Tell what God's done for you. Tell what Jesus has done for you. Offer to pray for somebody. Is there a need? Just ask them, do you have a need that I could pray for you? Offer to pray. Offer to be that light, that witness. That's what being part of the church, being that influence in our community is. All hearts clear. Brother Mike, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer?
Precious Lord and Heavenly Father, we come to you and thank you and praise your holy, righteous, and wonderful name. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity you've had today. Come and study your word, to hear messages from your word. Bless them to our hearts and to our minds. Help us to take these words with us as we go throughout our days and share them with others, let them be seeds to bring others to you, to glorify and lift up your name. And with those that are ill, that are losses, loved ones recently, Lord, we pray that you'd be with them and console them and let them know that all things are done that are done through your hand, Lord, and by your will. Help us to understand those things. In Jesus' precious name.